Right, so this is a look at jig design. So remember from last time when we did the intro to workholding lecture, we made a distinction between jigs and fixtures, and we said that a jig is a workholding device that guides a tool of some kind. For example, a router bit or a drill bit. So the reason you're going to use drill jigs to minimize tool breakage, you may have drilled in the past with drill metal, like with a drill press or even with a hand drill, and you'll notice that it's really difficult unless you do a center punch or use a spot drill or some other means to keep the drill located on point. Much easier to do that if you have a drill jig. The jig actually guides the drill bit. And if you have like a sloped surface or a curved surface, those are really terrible situations for getting a drill bit started. And a drill jig can help with that. Also, minimize human error, reduce cycle time, improve accuracy, those things. And it kind of begs a question as to why you don't just use CNC. And that is a pretty valid question. CNC is a really good answer a lot of the time, but it's a lot of overhead sometimes when maybe all you need is to get a few holes drilled in the right location. Yeah, you don't need to spend tens of thousands of dollars on another CNC machine. You just need to use the drill press that you already have or that's not being used, and use a jig of some kind. So there's still a place for this kind of thing. There's a lot of manufacturing that gets done even today that's not on a CNC machine. So there are different types of jigs, and I've got some illustrations of these, so we'll just kind of go through and look at them kind of individually. The simplest is a template jig, and a lot of times these will have drill bushings mounted in here. I've put bushings in all of these drawings, but you can have a jig that doesn't use bushings. You can have a drill jig that doesn't use bushings. It's kind of a nice idea to have bushings, but you can do a template jig just even out of something as simple as a piece of acrylic or something like that. The more robust you make it, the more longevity you're going to get out of it, the more accuracy and things like that. So I put in drill bushings in all of these. So a template jig just has some way to locate itself on the, generally on the corner of a piece of work, not necessarily though, but just some way to locate it, and then some way of getting the holes put in there. So it doesn't have really a work holding feature in it, integrated in. So you could use something like some vice grip clamps and actually clamp these two together, maybe get a little bit better results out of it. You can also have ring style template jigs. Here you see one that's designed to work on the end of this hollow cylinder. So we've got this hollow cylinder, and I'll just hide that. So this is the jig itself, and you see that it has a groove cut around the inside here, and that allows for a little bit of burr clearance on the end. It will nest down inside of that cylinder, and you'll drill the first hole, and typically what you do with these is you'll drill one hole, and then you want to keep this thing from twisting. So if there's nothing that's keeping it from twisting, it's pretty common to take a pin and drop a pin down in here after you've drilled the first hole, and that will fix the jig relative to the rest of the holes as you go around. So these template jigs, you've got to be careful because you can make bad parts just as easily as you can make good parts if you're not careful about how you maintain the orientation there. And this is a nested template jig. So this part, the outline of this part is actually machined into the jig itself. So the part will slip down in there, or the jig will rest down on top of the part. It will be nested up in there. It will slide up in there. And then you'll drill from the backside the holes through the bushings. So these have kind of one problem in that they don't really follow the 3-2-1 locating rule. And so if you have enough clearance for this part to fit into that nest, then generally you you've got some amount of movement that's going to be allowed. You know, remember this part, when you make these parts, they're not going to be perfect. And if you have enough clearance for it to slip in there easily, you may have enough clearance for the thing to move. So what I kind of would prefer would be something like 3-2-1 in mounting. If we had, like in this case, we've got these nice perpendicular sides, maybe have a 3-2-1 jig might work a little bit better. But this is an option. So we're really just trying to understand the different types of jigs. I will say one way to make a jig is to actually cast plastic in place around the jig. So you put a pin and get the bushings. You have a prototype workpiece that's made, and you attach bushings to it, and then cast some kind of polyurethane or some other type of plastic around, you know, like epoxy, for instance, around that part, and actually make a nested jig from that. But again, you've got to remember that, you know, it may fit on the first part very well, but you may have trouble down the line if you have any kind of variation in the form or size of those parts. All right, the next type of jig is a plate jig. So if you've got a plate jig, it's kind of like a template jig, pretty straightforward, configuration. Really just a plate with some hole locations marked with bushings. But with a plate jig, you've added some kind of work holding device. So in this case, it's these two knobs over here, and you can see we've got the 3-2-1 pins. Actually, in this case, you know, our 3 is strictly coming from the plate itself, so we actually have a plane mount there. Maybe not ideal, but you know, that's not really a rule that you have to always follow. So it really just depends on the application. So we've got the three pins up against these two, and then against the other one. And the way this is done is this would sit down onto a block of some kind, like a spoil plate that you could drill down into. And when the drill comes in through the drill bushings, when it pushes against this block, it's not going to push it free. So we don't really need clamping in that direction. We just need to be able to affix the plate, the jig, onto the work. Another type of jig is a channel jig. So here's this channel jig, and of course the channel is just a U-shaped piece of metal in this case. And you know, these when you see this, it kind of makes you think of a piece of structural steel maybe, and you can use structural steel to make these things. But I do like to mention, when I'm talking about structural steel with students, especially in something as precision-oriented as work holding, is that structural steel is made to be strong. It's not made to be precisely machined. And so you need to be careful with using things like structural C-channel. That stuff is not very precisely made. And of course, on C-channel, you'll have to deal with these surfaces being tapered. In this case, they're not. This is not structural steel. This could be. These could also be built-up pieces. You could, bolt. Use socket head cap screws and dowel pins in this case to connect the pieces together. Or this could be welded construction. Or you could have even a cast piece of steel like this. So when you're designing stuff like this, you want to think, you know, where is this channel shape going to come from? Just because you can draw it doesn't mean that it's an easy thing to make, and so you need to consider that. In this case, I did round the insides so that you could see that we're using the pins to actually do the locating. All right, let me do it like that. Okay, so we don't have to worry too much about these being rounded, because we're not locating off of the inside surfaces of the actual channel, we're locating off of the pins. And here you see I've relieved this locating pin with a little groove in there, so that if there's a burr on the edge of our workpiece, which is shown here as being clear, that won't affect the position left and right. And you can also have a box jig that sort of completely encloses the workpiece. Here's that box jig, so you can actually approach the work from any of the four sides around, and in fact you could close off one end or the other and actually drill in at least five of the sides, and depending, you may even have a hinged side, and be able to drill all six sides, be able to approach from all six sides of the part. But in this case, you can see the clamps, the knobs, tightening against the side that has the two pins on this side. So those line up with those pins and kind of match it. And then the odd knob against two more pins. And of course, the bushings installed there. All right, and then I said that you could have a side that opens up, and that's typically what a leaf jig does. It's just kind of flaps open, and you drop your workpiece in there. There's the leaf jig. In this case, I put two, I put two pins on one side. So we're still doing 3-2-1, but we're not mounting. Again, I'm mounting flat on that surface. You could further maybe improve this by mounting on a locator or three locators, but I'm using the plane because in this case I've actually got a contact mount between the bushings on the backside and the surface of the material that I'm drilling. So you can maybe see those bushings in there that are mounted so that they're in contact with the surface. I have a gap on the top. So we'll talk a little bit about the clearance around the bushing in just a second. But I've got the two pins on that side, so the part goes in, slides against a single pin down here. It's actually pressed into place with this spring-loaded locator. So you open this jig up. It's hinged on this part. So you open this thing up, drop the part in against the two pins, and the spring pushes it against that single pin down there, down at the end, and you tighten these knobs to fixture the part in place. Then you close the leaf part, that's this hinged piece that makes it a leaf jig, and then that's held shut with the toggle clamp there. So that's a leaf jig. All right, then there's also a type of jig called a universal jig, and these are come in various arrangements. This is a pretty famous one, though. This is that Regulus universal jig. In this video, a guy kind of shows off how that thing works. Essentially, what you're able to do is put in different size bushings for different size holes that you might want to drill. And there's a V-block in here that will position tubular products on center with that jig. And then you have a stop down here that will allow you to make the hole a certain distance in from the end of the part. But that's that video is in the slides, so I would encourage you to kind of watch, at least kind of scrub the timeline with that and get the idea of how those universal jigs work. All right, so most of those jigs that we were looking at use drill bushings. There is an ANSI standard for bushings so that you can buy these from different manufacturers and they'll work in your jig. First, there is the type, and I'll break that down here in just a second. There are different types of drill bushings. And then the outside diameter. So this is the size the outside of the bushing. This is the hole that you're going to drill in your fixture, not the hole that the bushing is designed to drill. And so this number is coded. This is the number of 64ths. All right. So when you see a designation like this, it's got the 20 in here. That's the number of 64ths. So 20 64ths is 0.3125, or you could have reduced that down and seen that it's 5/16. So 5/16 is the same thing as 20 64ths. And if you're, so that's how you would find that out. This is just the number of 64ths. And what I like to do is convert it to a decimal, and then it should hopefully look like something a little bit more familiar, like 0.3125. Then the next one is the number of the length of the bushing. Now, this doesn't have to be nearly have as high resolution as something like the outside diameter does. And so it's the number in 16ths. Okay, so this one is a 1-inch bushing because it is 16/16 long. Then finally, the number at the end in decimal parts of an inch, that is the diameter of the drill that the bushing is designed to work with. Okay, so you don't have to worry about the fit so much. If you had a 1/8 inch hole, then a 1/8 inch drill bit wouldn't fit in there very nicely. But this is designed to fit a 1/8 inch drill bit. All right, you can see there's also a metric version of this that tacks the M on so that you know that you're dealing with a metric bushings. So these are the different bushing types, and Carl Lane has got some really good information on bushings. This technical information is really good. They've got a whole lot of this on their website, but these are some of the different types. Okay, so you've got the press fit bushings, renewable bushings, coolant bushings, chip breaker bushings. Let me just find some of these, and these will break down. You can have headed types or the non-headed types. So there's several of those. These are just the ones that are good to be familiar with. These are some pretty common types here. Whoops. All right, so when you're selecting a bushing, you can use these for drilling, tapping, and or reaming, and you want to make sure that you're getting the right bushing for that purpose. How long you're going to use that bushing is going to somewhat dictate the type of bushing that you use. We said sometimes if you've got really short run production, you might be able to get away with not even using bushings at all, but it's probably almost as much work and expense to go ahead and use the bushings, and then if you need to change them out, you can change them out. Carbide bushings offer an exceptional long life, but they're going to be more expensive, and you may also need some kind of specific type of steel or stainless steel, for instance, depending on the environment where you're using the jig. You might need a tin coating on there. Also, renewable bushings, a little bit more expensive, but much easier to change out than press fit bushings. They will they'll slip in, and then they're fixed in place with a screw, and so much easier to put in and take out. I will say a lot can go wrong when you're press fitting bushings, and I think we'll talk about that in a little bit. Also, when holes get very close together, you know these bushings take up room, and if you have holes that are close together, you may need to use thin wall bushings, which are a little bit more problematic because you have to have a more precisely sized hole that you're press fitting those bushings into. And also, if you have a head on those bushings, a lot of times you'll have to grind or order bushings with a flat ground onto the actual head so that the head doesn't take up space between the holes. So holes spaced close together sometimes require special attention in terms of bushings. All right, so mounting bushings a lot of times is done with press fit, and really the way to do that properly is with a tool called an arbor press. So you don't want to use hammers or something like that to drive press fit bushings. That's just asking for trouble. But use an arbor press. And you want to make very sure that, number one, that the hole is drilled and bored or reamed to the proper size, because press fitting requires a very narrow tolerance, a tight tolerance on size. The size limits for press fitting bushings is pretty narrow. So for instance, this is Carl Lane's recommendation for like a half inch drill bushing. The recommended hole size, so you say, is 0.5007 to 0.501. All right, so just a few tenths, a few ten thousandths of an inch of tolerance for that press fit. So that's one of the easiest things to get wrong, is to get that hole the wrong size. So if you wind up with a hole that's too small, then you wind up warping the bushing itself, or damaging the entire jig. You know, you try to press fit that thing in there, and you wind up tearing up the jig itself, or you wind up distorting the bushing. If you don't have enough interference, then you can wind up with a bushing that slips out, that's not held in place properly. All right, so you want to make sure that that when you press fit those bushings, number one, that the hole size is within the right limits, that it's been drilled and reamed or bored to the right size, and you know, to within those limits. But you have to pay attention to those tolerances. Very important. Also, make sure that the you know, the bushing, well, as they come from the manufacturer, they're going to have a little chamfer on the end that's going to allow them to lead into the hole properly. But if you have done something like grind that end short on the bushing, if you've ground the end of the bushing flat, you want to make sure that you put that chamfer back on there, because it's going to be held to press fit that if you don't have a little chamfer lead in on the end of the bushing. Also, you want to lubricate the bushing before press fitting. And like I said, you want to have an arbor press to do this. Don't even think about using like a hammer to mount these. You know, a vise is not a very good idea either. I will plead guilty to having used a vise to do press fitting, but really the best way to do it is with an arbor press. All right, we talked a little bit about clearance at the end of the bushing, and there are two main different ways you can do this, with a contact mount or with a gap mount. And the contact mount is typically not recommended. When you do a contact mount, the chips have to find their way all the way outside the bushing. So you have the additional, you've got the depth of the hole that the chips have to find their way out of. And then additionally, they have to work their way all the way out of this bushing. In general, it's not recommended. The only time it is recommended really is when you have like a sloped surface or a curved surface that you're trying to drill into. And I would say try to avoid those kinds of surfaces anyway, because that is very tough on a drill bit to try to start drilling out here with the outside edge of the drill and not with the tip. If it's slightly sloped so that you start with the tip, that's kind of the best of the worst case. So, you know, you want to try to avoid that. But that's really the only time that you need a contact mount, the only time it's recommended. On the other hand, you can have a gap mount. Now, this gap is shown awfully exaggerated. It really should not be that much. About a half a drill diameter to a 1.5 drill diameters would be typical. And the more you increase this gap, the less accuracy you're going to get. So this gap is almost 2 diameters, and that's really just that's just too much. But for the purposes of illustration, we will let that fly. Oh, and I should say the difference in why you would use a half drill diameter to 1.5 inches has to do with the type of chips that you're getting. So if you're drilling something like cast iron or certain types of brass where you get really short chips that are just chopped up, then you can go with a half drill diameter. If you're drilling something like an austenitic stainless steel or a lot of types of aluminum, or titanium, some of these will want to make long stringy chips, and so you'll want more clearance in there. But remembering that the more you increase that clearance, the less accuracy you're going to have. All right, so just some best practices. Make sure that the bushings are properly aligned. Keep the tools sharp. Use coolant as you would anyway. Slip fixed renewable bushings are much easier to deal with and much easier to replace than press fit bushings. If you have an irregular surface, you want the bushing to actually adapt to that irregular surface. And carbide and tin coated bushings will wear much longer than ordinary hardened steel bushings. There is this additional little note out here. There's not a lot of this on the interwebs out there about jig bores and jig grinders, but these are pretty remarkable machines that that had sort of their heyday, you know, just after World War II, in that time period when these were the kings of the shop. These were just the most accurate machines by far, a very robust machine, very accurate feed mechanisms, temperature control, the whole works. These were pretty amazing machines, and they were used to drill and create these jigs that we're talking about. So pretty interesting little foray into jig bores or jig grinders. If you're not familiar with that technology, I would recommend that you go out and watch that video from Suburban Tool. But that's all I've got to say about jigs and jig design, and we'll lop it off there.